Now, if I do this and the person feels pain, we call this allodynia. And allodynia is an abnormal sensation, of course, because this is just a light touch, very light. So, should not hurt, but some people will feel pain. Hi, I'm Dr. Andrea Furlan, and today I'll be talking about sensory examination, how this is important, how it is done in a patient that has chronic pain. So let's talk a little bit about sensation. One of the sensations we test in people with chronic pain is sensation to light touch. So light touch, we use a paper tissue like this or a cotton ball. And if we touch the skin of a person that doesn't have any abnormality in the sensations, they will feel this like a light touch. Now, if I do this, and the person feels pain, we call this allodynia. And allodynia is an abnormal sensation, of course, because this is just a light touch, very light. So should not hurt, but some people will feel pain. And some people also, when I do this, they will feel numbness. They will be anesthetized. They will not feel it. So that's also abnormal. So what's going on? This is called allodynia. Allodynia means it's a painful sensation. The person, the brain receives information that this is dangerous, this is painful, but it's not. We know this doesn't hurt. This is not damaging my skin. So what is the problem? Why the brain perceives this as dangerous? We actually don't know where is the problem, but we know that there is a problem. And this problem can be a transduction in the receptors of the skin. So the problem can be here where the receptors are. But we know that these receptors, they travel. There is an electrical impulse that will travel to the spinal cord. They use fibers that are kind of large fibers. They are A-beta fibers. They have myelin. They are kind of large. So they go pretty fast. They arrive in the spinal cord. So it could be in this, when they're traveling to the spinal cord in the nerves, that there's some crisscross or there's a short circuit there. Or it could be in the spinal cord itself. It could be at the level of the spinal cord that there is, when the impulse enters the spinal cord in the dorsal horn, that there's something there. Or it could be from the spinal cord when it's going up to the brain. So this crisscross, this short circuit, can happen in many places. What we know is that there is something abnormal. That's why we call allodynia. It's interesting that allodynia is also possible. We can have allodynia to pressure. So if I apply certain pressure to my skin, it should not hurt. But if I apply a lot of pressure, then it's going to hurt, right? So what is a little bit of pressure? What is a lot of pressure? It's usually by the time that my nail starts blanching, then I know I'm applying too much pressure. So if I'm just touching and apply a little bit of pressure and the person feels pain, that's also called allodynia. It is pressure-evoked allodynia. This is touch-evoked allodynia. We can also have allodynia to hot things. If I apply something hot to my skin, that a normal person without an abnormality would feel this is warm or this is hot, but it's not painful. If I apply to someone who has allodynia to warm, because those are different fibers, those are C fibers that carry that information, then I detected allodynia, a warm evoked allodynia. I can also evoke allodynia with cold. If I apply something cold to the skin, and a normal person would say, oh, this is just cold, but it's not hurting. And if I apply this to a person that has abnormality in the pain system, they're going to say, no, 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 this is hurting me. So anything that is above, we call hyper. Anything that is below, we call hypo. So a person can have hypersensitivity or hyposensitivity. The other sensation that we also test is the pain fibers. So those are the A delta fibers. And we usually use something that is sharp, like it could be a toothpick, a needle, a Sharpie thing, could be a paper clip that we open. So something that is very sharp, because now this thing here is activating different fibers, different from these ones. These are certain receptors detect this sensation in the skin. This is a different one, and they go from different fibers. This go A delta fibers, this go through the A beta fibers. A beta is larger than the A delta. And the warm sensation goes to the C fibers. C fibers, they don't have any myelin, so they're very, very thin. We call those the small fibers. So if I'm testing something that is painful, so this is not pleasant. So this is kind of activating the pain receptors, and my brain is detecting this is pain, but it's pain that I can tolerate. Now, if I do this in a person that has an abnormal pain system, and the person, I do this and they jump, they say, what are you doing? It's too much. I feel like a knife. This is not a knife. This is just a toothpick, but they feel like a knife. This is called hyperalgesia. They're feeling more the pain. Algesia means pain. Hyper is more. So more pain to a stimulus that is small. The person may also have hypoalgesia, that this is supposed to hurt. It's not pleasant. We call, and especially if I start doing a lot, the person should say, oh, it's not pleasant. But if the person says, no, I don't feel, I feel blunt. Like it looks like you're doing something like this. It's not like this. That's abnormal. That's hypoalgesia. Now, if I do this and the person has no idea where I'm touching, I usually do this test with the person with the eyes closed. I ask them to close their eyes and then I test. And sometimes I'm touching their skin and they have no idea where I'm touching because they are numb, they are anesthetized. So then we call, it's not even hypoalgesia, it's anesthesia. They have no sensation. Now, why this is so important? Because these are all the sensors that we have for danger. And our skin is so innervated with sensors for danger. We have tons and millions of sensors around our skin. And we have sensors for light touch, for pressure, for heat, for cold, for pain, because we do need to alert our brain of what is going on outside of our body. So our pain, our skin is our interaction with the exterior. So it is important because then we can detect there are some abnormal sensations, abnormal, your pain system is deregulated. So why is deregulated? So the question is, what makes this pain system deregulated? And I can explain to you there are a lot of things that can deregulate the pain system. These sensations, they are in, it's important that we map them. So usually I start with this area here of the face of the patient because this is innervated by the trigeminal nerve. It's usually preserved, this area. It can be abnormal, but it's usually preserved. And then we compare the rest of their body with the face. So I do this and I say, compare your face with your arm. Is it the same? Is it more? Is it less? And I ask them to close their eyes when they're doing this. And then it's important that when I do this for all sensations, we do this for all of those. And then what we do is we also want to try to map, is this the hemi body that is abnormal? That could be a stroke. It could be a thalamic problem. Is it just one arm? Then it could be a radiculopathy. So if there is a very specific portion of my arm that is like here, I know this is probably C6. So the cervical six nerve root on this side that it might be being pinched because I have abnormal sensations on my C6 dermatome. Or it could be that it's just in this area here that is innervated by the median nerve. The median nerve is a nerve that innervates this part here. It's usually affected when a person has carpal tunnel syndrome. So if everything else is normal, but the area of the median nerve is affected, I said, okay, maybe all of these abnormal sensations are happening because there is a median nerve compression here at the wrist, and this is called carpal tunnel syndrome. It's a neuropathic pain. and then there's a neuropathic symptom. Now, sometimes these abnormalities, they don't follow a pattern. It's not a nerve root. It's not a brain injury. It's not a spinal cord injury. It's not a peripheral nerve. And they change. The important thing is, like in the morning, this was hyper, and now in the afternoon, it might be hypo. We see this all the time. And this is because it's nociplastic pain. So plasticity in the pain system changes, and it can change the day, the time of the day. It can also change with how the emotions of the person are. If the person is more stressed, more fearful, more angry, they may have more hyperalgesia, more sensations. If they're calm and they can calm down their system, especially the sympathetic nerve system, some of those abnormalities can normalize because that's nociplastic pain. So that's why it's so important for us to do a physical examination, including the sensations, because we can detect allodynia, we can detect hyperalgesia, hypoalgesia, and we can also, another test that we can do, we can also do a test called hyperpathia. So what is hyperpathia? We use the sharp, we use the painful stimulation, and we choose one area that the person has pain, usually the area of most painful area. Let's say that the person says, oh, here is the most painful area, it's here. So we'll do here, we'll do one sensation, we'll do one, it has to be the painful one. And then we keep repeating, like once every second. So we keep repeating this. So if a person has the normal pain system, especially in the spinal cord, they don't have the wind up phenomenon, they will feel all of these sensations will be felt the same. So we ask them to give a number. I say from 0 to 10, how unpleasant is this? So they can say, oh, it's a 2 out of 10. It's okay. So I keep repeating this, maybe 1 per second or 2 per second. And then if the person has hyperpathia, which is a sign of neuropathic or nociplastic pain, then they will be adding this pain. So it's almost like each one of them adds more pain. So at some point they will say, it's getting worse. It's getting worse. Stop. Because then you reach a threshold that is too painful. If you detect this, it's called hyperpathia. And then it's a sign that they have the wind up phenomenon in the spinal cord. And we see this with nociplastic pain and also some case of neuropathic pain. So that's why it's so important to do this, the sensory exam. Doctors should learn how to do this and should do this when they're examining a patient with chronic pain, especially if they have any signs of neurological pain or nociplastic pain, because those signs are really important for a complete physical examination.